I'm Charlie Hume, product manager for the ATS line here at the Power Experience Center, and we're going to run through the operation of our bypass isolation transfer switch. This is a 400 amp design, and it's connected up to 480 volts. As we look at the anatomy of the transfer switch, you'll notice that there are two doors, an upper door and a lower door. The lower door is labeled ATS for automatic transfer switch, and the upper door is labeled bypass for the automatic bypass switch. To the right of both of those is a third compartment or third door that houses all the control logic and circuitry. And we'll start with a brief overview of what is showing here on the controller. We have a mimic bus that shows source one. It is available at present. The load is connected to source one. We also have source two, which is available. And down below that is our screen showing the voltages on each of the line-to-line voltages. We have current showing. And then below that is the operation panel. So this upper switch here is a four-position switch. On the left-hand side is the controls for the automatic transfer switch, which is again down in the lower compartment. And on the right-hand side are the controls for the bypass switch, or the automatic bypass switch, which is in the upper compartment. So right now the switch is in the automatic operation position, meaning that if we were to lose source one power, we would transfer over to source two. And we're simulating that now. So we have just removed source one power. The contacts did open and close. We are now connected to source two. There's a banner notifying us that we had a source one under voltage condition. If we bring back source one power, the transfer switch retransfers back to source one. So pretty straightforward. If I decide that I want to operate the transfer switch in a non-automatic fashion, meaning I'm going to disable the automatic controller, I can rotate this switch one position to the left. The banner up on the screen will tell me that I'm in monitor mode. The monitor mode tells me that I've disabled the controller. And with that, I can drop down to the source select switch, and I can rotate that to the off position. I've now disconnected the load from either source. I can rotate it to the source two position. Load shows it's connected to source two. And back to source one. So I have the ability to control using this switch itself the position of the contactor housed inside the ATS. If I return this back to the automatic position, the controller now is enabled again. So it's ready and active to make a transfer if needed. So if we talk about a bypass isolation switch, one of the purposes is having the ability to perform maintenance concurrently on the transfer switch while it is energized. So this is for use in critical applications where you can't afford to have downtime. And so the way we're able to achieve that is by shifting operation from the ATS up to the bypass switch. And we can move the operation, if you will, from lower to upper by rotating the switch to the right. I've completed a closed transition now from the ATS up to the bypass. I closed on the source one source up here, and I open the main contacts and disengage from the source one source down in the ATS section. So now the bypass is active. It's reflected here with this green light, which now allows me to be able to test and exercise this in the cell. If I drop down to the lower portion of this control panel, there is a procedure in three steps, one, two, three, telling me what I need to do. The first is to press this button. If I hold it in, it gives me or shows me all my lights are functioning properly. If I release it, it's going to indicate which contactor can be racked out and isolated in the cell for test. So with this light on, I can raise this shutter window. Using this ratchet, I can begin the process of racking out the ATS contactor. And what I'm going to keep an eye on here in step two is this light that's labeled ATS. Right now it's off. As I begin to rack this out, it's going to turn solid. And once it starts flashing, that means the lower contactor is in the isolated position within the cell. So it's now gone to a solid because I've started to move it. And I'm going to continue that process until it flashes. And what's happening as I move this contactor or rack this contactor out is the connections at the rear to the bus are separating. I'm disengaging from the rear bus. Now the contactor, or the light is blinking, so the contactor is in the isolated position. I can now move to step three and I can enable test mode. And once I've done that, using the source select switch, I can operate the main contacts. And so I have the ability now, and I'm not sure if the sound is coming through, but you can hear the main contacts opening and closing as I'm operating the main contacts. And so that's going to give me confidence that my contactor is working properly for when I do need it, it will function. Now in this instance, if I was to lose power, I have the ability with my automatic bypass switch to be able to still transfer the load. So we have simulated a loss on source one, and the bypass switch has automatically transferred the load to source two. That's with this contactor isolated and withdrawn off the rear stabs. So that's a critical function for this switch to be able to maintain power to the load should you lose power during this process. If we bring source one back, the bypass switch reconnects us to the source one, and we're off and running as we were previously. I also have the ability to operate the switch non-automatically, the bypass switch. So using this, again, the source select switch, I can operate the bypass switch, and my load's connected to source two, my load's disconnected, and my load's connected back again to source one. So I do have the ability to put this in a non-automatic operation mode while this is isolated in the cell. And the reason why that may be important to some people is if I'm standing in front of the gear and this is in automatic mode, I may not feel comfortable with the transfer switch transferring with me being in such close proximity. So I do have the option to put this in non-automatic mode and manually monitor what's happening with the source and be able to initiate the transfer myself. When I do that, I have to remember to take it out of the test mode on the lower switch here, because otherwise I won't be able to operate this non-automatically. So I'll bring it back to the automatic position and I'll continue finishing up what I was doing with the ATS. I'll start the rack-in procedure now. And what I'm going to look for is this switch going out. So it's turned to solid. It went from blinking to solid, which means it's starting to rack back in on the stabs. During this time period, you may hear the contactor disengage, the ATS contactor, and that's because, as we were testing it previously, if we left the contacts in a closed position, the safety interlock will prevent the transfer switch from racking in with the contact closed. So we don't want to have the contact close and create an arc condition as we rack this back in on the stabs. So I've now racked this in. The light is off. I can lower the shutter and I can return this back to the automatic operation mode on the ATS. So if we've restored the original state of the transfer switch and it's ready for operation. Now, another feature is this third compartment, as I mentioned earlier, which houses all the control circuitry. So at any point, if I need to service any of the components in here, this door, this third door, allows me to have access to everything. But before I open this, there's a decision to be made whether I want to maintain power or if I want to rotate this to the maintenance position. The maintenance position removes all the system voltage and the control voltage into the compartment, making it safer for me, the worker in this case, from going in and operating on anything. You'll notice the controller is still powered up. It takes about 20 seconds for it to go out. It's got some capacitors that stay charged to keep it up and running to ride through short power outages. But that's all DC voltage, 24 volts, completely safe. But if you want to be sure, wait for the controller to go out and then open the door. And you can pull this forward. The switch that we rotated is housed in a steel shroud, so that's completely isolated from everything else. And the wiring is all recessed back into the compartment, but it allows you to work on the controller. We have a DCT module that's attached to the rear. We have the lights and the switches, so the light need to be replaced or a switch replaced. We have terminal blocks to land new wiring. We have relays. We have a DC buffer. We have our control power transformer, which is up top here. Down on the bottom, we have some communication modules that can be accessed. So this allows you easy access to this compartment, making it more safe without the shock hazard, while still maintaining power to the load. Power is still flowing through the ATS to the load. The only thing that we've lost during this maintenance process is that the controller is now off, so we lose automatic operation. So if there was a loss of power, the transfer switch would not transfer. If that was important to us, we could keep the switch in the normal operation position, and we would suit up in our appropriate PPE, and then we would pull out the draw and then have the panel accessible to us with the controller still powered up. But in this instance, we moved it to the maintenance position to make it safer. So once I'm finished, I can close the door, and I've restored operation to the original condition. And that concludes the presentation.